Hi, I'm John Tejada, here on Ask the Producer, Electronic Beats, having me on to answer your questions. And I'm a recording artist based in Los Angeles, California. I've been working on electronic music since the early 90s. I've released on quite a few labels. At the moment, I'm mostly recording for my own label, which is called Palette Recordings, which is about to turn 25. I record for Kompakt Records in Cologne. And with Reggie Watts, I have a duo called Wahada, which we record for Brainfeeder Records here in LA. So let's get into it. Let's get started. Mr. Babahu asks, when working on a new track, how does the arrangement come to life? Do you have a sort of recipe you tend to apply to your production? Are you organized in how you develop a track, or is it more lucky and tries that lead you to build tracks a certain way? For myself, the arrangement can definitely be the most difficult part of creative workflow. I think in part because when I was learning my studio tools back in the day, they just weren't really endless, right? If it was a pattern-based sequencer I was working with, or even a early MIDI sequencer, the possibilities weren't really endless, right? And now, I mean, it never ends. So I think that's the challenge, is kind of having that groove that you settled into when you were, you know, kind of getting your certain parts set up. And for me, it's not trying to be too tricky with it and to reinvent the wheel, right? Just to kind of have that groove going and not to be more clever than I think I can be, if that makes any sense. And yeah, obviously, when that goes quicker rather than slower, that's kind of like a good zone to be in. So it takes practice. I feel like that's something I am working on all the time, is just how to finish the songs, keep them interesting, but not take it too far and to get too crazy with it. So I don't really have a recipe that I follow every time. It depends on the type of track I'm making. You know, if it's more functional club, if it's more sort of soundscapey, sound designy. But I do like to have that groove throughout, and kind of, at least for myself, have this kind of coherent flow that hopefully I can manage to have through the track, even if I have different sections, like an A and a B and a C section working together, right? Sometimes it is just luck, you know. Sometimes if I'm really in the creative flow and I can kind of think ahead, I'm sure this happens for all of you, you just kind of start to piece it together before you get there. And those are the good days when everything is working out and your arms are just kind of following your brain, right? Brian Scott asks, how has your style developed from when you started, and what is your current source of inspiration? It's interesting. I think I have this conversation with a lot of producer friends quite often, but I think the excitement that gets us started in producing, it's just almost very childlike, right? Like whatever sort of comes natural to us, we sort of develop it really quickly. And I think that's why you have these sort of classic artists with very distinct styles, right? So I almost find, like, as we age and try new things and try different technology and whatever it might be, we sort of start to think that's too easy, or speaking for myself, something can seem too easy and it's like, well, I don't want to do that anymore. But then everything kind of comes in waves. After a long time, that body of work becomes really unique. And even when there was a time when it seemed like everybody was kind of on the same tip, now it's different all of a sudden. And all of a sudden, you know, whatever I might have done 25 years ago, there might be something unique to it. So I feel like the journey is to kind of embrace that and to kind of embrace it and build upon that, rather than just trying to reinvent the wheel all the time and just being kind of at ease with, like, basically who I am musically, right? And it all gets a bit confusing because, you know, new tech will be really exciting or influences from other producers. You mentioned your question is, what's my biggest inspiration? My biggest inspiration even now is a lot of this music that I heard when I was young that just sounded like, you know, alien transmissions. Like, I remember there's some songs I heard for the first time, like, kind of falling asleep listening to the radio and not really even sure if I heard them. So those are kind of special moments. And actually, at the moment, I'm teaching at CalArts a fall class, which is History of Electronic Dance Music. And it's so interesting to play a lot of this music that basically made me who I am to students that haven't heard a majority of it, you know, and I wonder, like, is this affecting, does this still have that effect? Because to me, I'll hear those tracks, I could list dozens and hundreds of them, but they'll still give me goosebumps. Like, I'll make playlists, right, to share every week. And for me, a constant source of inspiration is kind of going back to a lot of that. And for me, I really love these kind of rule breakers, right? Like, everything back to the BBC Radiophonic Workshop, to, like, Art of Noise, to all these musicians and producers that solve problems using tech that wasn't really in place yet, essentially inventing the way we work today. There's a story of Marley Marl being the first to kind of sample kicks and snares. I think Art of Noise did a bit of that too, but I mean, they had a Fairlight. That wasn't a thing that was in hip hop yet. So I love these happy accidents that essentially went on to spawn a subgenre of music. And just to think about how those producers got around their challenges and how they made these amazing hits with the technology they had at the time, when, you know, sometimes you'll be in your studio, sky's the limit, and nothing's happening. It's just like, you know, there'll be this classic song made with 2.5 seconds of sampling time, and I've got unlimited sampling time, and I, you know, and that might be the issue, right? So anyway, that's what inspires me. That's what makes me really, really happy, and I'm always looking for those moments. I know there's more out there to discover that I don't know about yet, and yeah, that's what I love, and that's what makes me want to make music and do what I do. Sunday Morning Mass Radio Show asks, how do you innovate your sound? Keep it new and timeless at the same time? Gear, other music, movies, life? Innovate my sound, keep it timeless. I mean, that sounds like compliments to me. I mean, I you know, I'm trying to, I like doing it. It makes me happy. I want it to, when it comes out right, in my eyes, it makes me happy. It makes me keep wanting to do it. I'm lucky that a few of the tunes have resonated with you all. That's why we're talking. So I think that's great. Gear can definitely inspire, but it can also sort of paralyze, right? Having all the tools and not being able to get something going, you know, you almost feel guilt. Like, I bought this thing, but I'm not using it today. Well, what's wrong with me? Why did I buy it? You know, and it's almost better just to keep it simple and focused. But yet, I love that I have toys to play with, and I feel very lucky to have them. So, you know, it's just trying to be chill and just letting that happy vibe kind of take you. Other music, yes. There's nothing like a day when I discover a great album or a great piece of music that inspires me. That's kind of what I live for. Movies, I love movies. I love watch a lot of movies. Sci-fi and horror being really inspirational for me. Life, yeah. I mean, I love outdoors. Here in LA, we get good weather year-round. I've recently gotten into BMXing, which is really fun. I didn't realize that was still a thing. I like jogging. I like playing golf. I like just being out. I hate the hot summers, but it's about to end at the time of filming. I hope we're getting a break. And I think all of that is connected, right? Like, people in my life that inspire me, it's great to see them. That's probably my favorite thing. And just kind of just working it out and getting out and doing something not related to music, but then somehow it's connected. And then an idea comes from nowhere and you don't even know where it came from. And it's like, wow, thanks, universe. That was great. I'll get right on that, you know? So it's all connected. It's all feelings and emotions and things, and, you know, especially the great movies that you can revisit. Yeah, it's all in the pot. I've got a question from Gino Ginelli. Are you still in love with the craft, or do you fall victim to the machine like many others and make things in order to get paid? I don't know if it's my perspective on the whole thing, but when I'm making my own, like, solo music, you know, my albums or my singles, I still kind of find, like, I need to find extra free time to work on them, meaning it's not a job. I don't go to the studio every day. I have to make stuff. Like, I still want to get that little creative bug and think, oh, I want to try to work this out. That this is exciting. This is fun. Or if I'm working with one of my collaborators, I have so much fun with music. I always have that. I really, really just instinctively kind of knew how to kind of keep it there. So the work part of it, I would say, is sort of doing remixes or times when I travel or other production work. What else goes along with it? Yeah, just different studio work or just sort of administrative office stuff, right? That's the sort of work part. Or teaching, but I really enjoy teaching as well. That's just kind of like I try to make it a fun hang, you know? I think any of us that have had the good fortune to have a little bit of, you know, get a bit of attention and get a little bit of money, that can definitely trip you up for a minute if you let it. And of course, I must have had that thought at some point of, you know, a follow-up or what will people think of this, but I really don't think that anymore. I think that's where the happy place is, and I think, just kind of settling into that, your own kind of musical personality, is just a good place to be, because once you start worrying about what other people think, I mean, this is all cliche, but that's just a long, unhealthy battle. At this point, I just feel very calm about wanting to be myself and to be different and to try things and not be afraid to, because, yeah, part of my profession is to put this stuff out there, right? So there is a little bit of decision-making in how, where, with who am I going to present my music, which music, and how I'm going to put it together. But when that sort of marketing brain, that sort of what am I going to get from it, part of it is eliminated from the equation, it all just becomes creative and fun. And then the sort of necessary evils in place, they become a fun tool to explore. So there's definitely some producers who kept making the same track after a certain time. And, you know, I definitely, you know, I feel like I had a few opportunities to just keep making the same track. Maybe some of you think that's what I do, which is fine. But, you know, the ones that sort of really resonate in a big way, apart from maybe one time trying to follow something up, I would say it's fun for me just to kind of flip the script and feel like I can challenge my listeners, which sounds crazy to say, and see if they'll kind of keep along with the journey. So I had a question from Klinkska. I hope I said that right. I probably didn't. How much do you feel you need to learn to get where you like to be? Are you 20, 60, or 85% mastered in your vision? I definitely feel more confident in being able to accomplish what I'd like to accomplish, but as far as, you know, waiting for inspiration to come, it doesn't always strike constantly. So I think that's the main ingredient there. As long as inspiration is happening, then yeah, I feel, you know, it's a growing process. I'm always learning, learning a great deal from students now. That's pretty amazing. As I mentioned before, it's really exciting for me to get together with like-minded creative friends. I don't know where I'm at percentage-wise. I mean, I think that's part of it. If I felt like I've mastered everything, it would get a bit boring, right? I mean, honestly, a lot of days I feel like I'm at 20%. Like, I want an idea. I hope I can execute it. You know, sometimes it's not so clear. I think generally the days when the ideas are coming and the production is happening fast, those are the 85% days, I think. And the days where it's not really working out, I'm deleting a bunch of stuff, those are the days when I feel like I'm 20% there, right? So, but that's part of the fun. Because those days when you're at 20%, that's when you want to unlock that next belt level, right? You want something to inspire you. You're looking, you're trying new tools, you want to learn to code, you know, whatever it might be. It takes you to that next level. And then you learn a bunch of stuff, and then all of a sudden you're back at 20% again, you know? And that's what keeps it going. All right, I've got a question from Nick Skywalker. How did you approach music production when you started? How has the way you approach it evolved over the course of your life? What inspired you and what inspires you now? We had this radio station here called KDAY, which we still have, but it was sort of different then. It was on AM, and there was a lot of DJs and a lot of mixing, and you would hear a lot of hip-hop, R&B, but you'd also hear a lot of electro. You hear like a little bit of house, a little bit of Detroit stuff, and that stuff caught my ear really young, like around like 10 years old. And it's interesting because a lot of the tools used then are still the tools that we sort of use now and are still very in demand, like the old Roland machines and old Jupiter 8s and, you know, you name it, classic synths. I didn't know what it was at the time. I just knew I liked it. I just knew it sounded really special. So I first wanted to learn how to DJ this kind of music because I was also very interested in that. But not too long after, probably like mid-teens, I started thinking about like, oh, what if I could actually make this kind of music? When I first got my first set of tools, which is, you know, this is back in 1990, 91, it was pretty limiting. So I remember I had an EPS sampler that I bought from DJ Newmark with a 4-time expansion. That gave me, I think, 26 seconds of sampling time. I quickly got a Casio CZ-101 and a Juno 60, which at the time they were like, you know, $250, not $2,500 or whatever they are now. That's all I had. And 26 seconds seemed amazing. And I would utilize every bit of that data. And once it was filled up, that's all I could do, right? So I would be as creative as I could with that. And that kind of goes back to talking about one of the earlier questions. Of having unlimited technology now and then getting stuck. Like, that just seems ridiculous, right? Like, I was happy as can be in my little bedroom setup at 17 using really limited gear, and I just was like, wow, like, still had no thoughts that I would make a record. Like, how do you make a record? Like, now, make a tune, publish it, and you're off, you know, Bandcamp, whatever you want to do. But back then, you know, you had to meet somebody or send cassettes in the mail, and you might need an agent. It was, you know, it just seemed like that's what other people do. Like, I don't make records, but I love this music and I want to try to make it. So that was my approach when I started. I was just happy I was making sounds. It was super exciting and I could play the music for my friends, and that's as far as I thought it would go, you know. I mean, when I really get into it now, I want to relive that happy moment of being just like amazed at what I can do with the technology I have. And, you know, the more and more we get, the more I kind of take it for granted. So I want to not feel that way. And then what inspired me then and now is kind of similar, right? Like it's music tech for sure, and discovering tools. But again, it's those producers that paved the way and did crazy stuff that someone told them they're not allowed to do or whatever. I mean, that's where it's at for me. And yeah, that's kind of what I live for. Eli Fan asks, how do you balance kick and bass? So that's something that is an ongoing thing that I'm working on. 30 plus years, we've all had that experience where we take a track to the car or play it on a system and it's wrong, right? So I think first off, monitoring is key, finding monitoring that really works for you, that you can trust. Second is learning the gain stage with a view meter and learning the relationship between the level of your music, the level of your music without a kick, without a bass. You can look this stuff up. It would be a really long explanation, but that's definitely helped me a lot because a view meter responds a little bit closer to our perceived loudness that we hear. So a lot of times when I'm not looking at a VU and I'm trying to balance by ear, I'll be way off, and then using a VU helps me quite a bit. Frequency analyzers a bit, just to make sure that there's not information that I'm not hearing that I don't need. I'm not a big fan of aggressively high-passing things, but you know, when you need it, it definitely helps. So I think between monitoring, listening to a lot of productions that you think sound perfect, and just kind of studying those. For example, there's a couple of tracks that in my memory, because they're so powerful, to me the kick and the bass are just massive. But when I go and listen to the track, the kick is actually quite small in relation to the bass. But the way it works, and especially when it's played on a system, it just sounds absolutely massive. So yeah, practice listening, get your monitoring as good as you can have it, and practice mixing, obviously, as you go. And use some analyzers and meters to get you that extra step, that extra mile there. Mars81 asks, do you EQ your kick? Yes, sure. You know, sometimes I'm using samples, sometimes using drum machines, sometimes I'm synthesizing something. And I feel, especially in modern production, EQ, of course, but if it's a good sound, right, that's kind of what I strive for, is to have a good sound, and then I don't have to EQ it so much. Saturation is kind of my best friend. Saturation can really do a lot more for me than compression. Sometimes compression can really kind of ruin something. So as my buddy Bob Power says, you know, turn the knobs till it sounds good. So that's generally what I'm doing. So definitely starting with a good sound that if you weren't able to do anything to it at all, I think that's a great place. Because if the sound is lacking too much, just, you know, it's going to be too much work and it's still not going to sound as strong as just starting with something that has the proper frequencies for what you're trying to accomplish, right? OlliG312, what's the recipe for great drums? I think starting with great sounds, the more you have to do to your sounds, kind of an uphill battle. So obviously sweetening sounds is great, but start with great sounds, whether it's acoustic, you know, the right mic placement, the right mics, the right room. Essentially a great sound that you don't have to do much to. Same with electronic. Have it gained right frequencies for what you're trying to do. It's interesting because with electronic music, we are not really using muscle memory as a drummer, right? So it's more the programming side of being creative. So I sort of started in drums when I was pretty young, so I feel really lucky in that I can sort of have a rhythm in my head, and I, whether I tap it out with pads or keys or, you know, paint it in with a step sequence or something, I've got kind of an idea. Usually, even when I'm just doing the melodic elements, I've got something going where I feel like I want to drop the drums into. So I'd say even if you don't play acoustic drums, it might be worth it just to get a practice pad and practice some rudiments and things, and just figure some of that muscle memory stuff out. It might get the juices flowing, even when it comes to programming. So, yeah, great sound and just some practice, and not kind of overdoing it. Give everything its own place. Easier said than done. I definitely can ruin it for myself. Got a question from Sebastian D. When you first started, how did you get the feeling that the song was finally over and finished? I guess I don't get too precious about it, meaning, you know, once I get it to the time length that I want and it's sort of in the ballpark, I may come back to it with fresh ears and usually take things away that are just too, don't need to be there, and maybe space phrases out so that they're a bit longer rather than just things kind of looping. That's the thing that I've worked on in the last couple of years, to work with longer phrases and just have little accents here and there, which I think breaks up the loopiness. All right. I think I've got a question from Lazy Bios. Sorry. All right. My current favorite piece of kit and why? At the moment, I'm actually quite into DSP, so I would say my computer. I've got some hardware stuff. It all serves a certain purpose, but when you compare it to the possibilities of DSP, I mean, there's so much there. I feel like if I could pick more than one, the computer is very important, and to sort of match it with interesting hardware to give it some richness, some harmonics. I think that's a really nice combination. Catherine asks, what's your advice for integrating hardware into DAW-centered sequenced rig, especially for live jam setting? One thing that's slightly annoying about integrating hardware and software is sync, right? So there's some sync solutions, and the good ones are a little pricey, but I think they're well worth it. I've used a Sync Gen Pro. I'm using an ERM multi-clock. There's also S&D Acme machine, and it's a bit annoying because they're an expensive utility, but they're made for one thing, and they do it very well. And I think once that is solved, that makes everything a heck of a lot more fun, because you don't have these problems with lining up and latency and everything. I mean, you still have to deal with software monitoring latency, but then, you know, at least the problems are whittled down a little bit. When it comes to the tools, I really don't think you can go wrong. Obviously, there's a lot of stuff out there, which is kind of amazing, because it definitely wasn't like that too long ago. Now there's just so many tools by young, fresh companies, and there's so much to choose from, and I really don't think you can go wrong. You just kind of pick stuff that resonates with you. I wouldn't buy classic things that are way, way overpriced. There's great new options out that are probably more interesting anyway. Find stuff that resonates with you. I don't think there's a list of things that all the cool kids have. You know, I think it's a little bit cooler to be a little bit out of the box and find something that, you know, maybe isn't so popular and you can do great stuff with. It's all useful and valid. So find what resonates with you. And then, you know, the utility side of it, just make sure that the clock and everything is working, because that can be a big killjoy. I got a question from Brandon NG. Hey, John, could you please walk me through how you set up your hardware with Ableton? Any favorite sequencers or favorite way to get your gear to talk to each other? So yeah, when I'm using hardware with Ableton, the external instrument plugin is a good friend of mine. I like this utility when I'm using Ableton, which is BIP, Bounce in Place, which if I have the external instrument inserted on a track, I can just hit a key and I can real-time bounce my hardware and it stays in time. I find that really helpful. It's sort of like a freeze and flatten, but it's a sort of real-time. Essentially, it creates a new track with a resample in and just kind of takes care of it for you. Although at the moment, I've actually plugged all my hardware into a line mixer, which goes through a couple of devices that have a little bit of color to them. So at the moment, all of my external instruments are coming in from the same input, the same pair of inputs. So I'm choosing which one on the mixer, which is kind of cool, actually, because then I can actually blend input signals, which is something I know I can do with external instrument plugins, but I just would never do it. So it's actually interesting to send the same MIDI line to multiple instruments and pan, place them, and do interesting stuff and layer as I'm doing it. So that's kind of opened me up a little bit, but it takes away a little bit of that routing freedom of just having every instrument plugged into its own hardware input. But I'm kind of enjoying that right now. So, and then the other thing is a sync generator, which if you're clocking anything, yeah, it's just, it's going to be worth the purchase, because otherwise it's very difficult. But right now I'm not really clocking too much stuff. I'm just kind of working more with MIDI. So that kind of makes it easier. Like the external instrument will do a pretty good job of compensating for any latency due to just hardware or software monitoring latency. So Mr. Bass 093 asks, how do you handle a creative block? That's a great question. Okay, first of all, it's almost like a panic attack, right? Like, try not to worry about it. Just, it's gonna end, you know, it's gonna be okay. Yeah, just to not force it, because maybe that creative block means you're ready to like graduate to the next belt level. A new idea is coming. You're just not sure where it is yet, you know, and then all of a sudden, bam, it's going to be there and you're going to take it and you're going to run with it, right? So a lot of times when I feel like I can't really produce a song, I'll just kind of try to be mellow about it. You know, sometimes collaborations, that'll get things going, because then I don't feel like I'm in this kind of solo bubble. But a lot of times I'm also trying to work out some tech, like some interesting process. I'll try to learn something. And a lot of times, a lot of the songs that I like will come from trying to learn some tech and, just trying to see if I can replicate what I think is happening. And sometimes that'll lead me to an happy accident where I'm actually doing something totally different, but all of a sudden I'm doing this and it's kind of interesting. And then just add a little bit of drums and all of a sudden I got something going. There was a lot of moments on my album I put out like 10 years ago, well, in 2011, called Parabolas, that I think kind of had a few cool moments on there of some things I wanted to figure out that I can't even remember how I figured them out, but it made for some interesting moments. So I think they made that work unique. DB303 asks, how do you generate your melodies? Do you use much music theory to guide the overall musicality of your tracks, or does it all come from messing around with sequencers, etc.? So I was a bit lucky to have a bit of musical background. Both my parents were classical musicians. I lived in Vienna until I was 8. My mother is from here, meaning LA, and I moved back with her. And with both my parents being musicians, is two things. One, I saw that every day they practiced their instrument, right? So I didn't really know any different. So that, I think, made a big impact. But that doesn't really answer the question you asked. But they got me started on piano pretty early. So even though it was, you know, young age, pretty simple stuff, I feel I retained some of that. Then later on in life, when I graduated high school, I went to a music school for a bit and I took a couple theory classes to brush up. And of course, I probably forgot a lot of that again. And now I'm teaching at CalArts and I'm kind of brushing up on some of that again. So I feel I have a little bit of it to help me, but obviously not something like a professional person reading a score chart. So I have a little bit of knowledge, and that definitely helps me. Generally, I'm happiest when I'm manually creating the chords or the melody by hand. Generative melodies are really fun and sometimes inspire something, but generally I won't use so much generative stuff because I feel like I didn't create it, right? So I may think I'm onto something cool, but in the end I feel like kind of it's like it's not my own. So sometimes it's a little bit worth it for me to just kind of struggle through the process and get something down that's me. And even if it's not as complex as I want it, just finding a way to make it work and to have it be interesting for myself. I did get a lot of inspiration from Justin Maxwell, who I've made a lot of records with. He's just great at step sequencers and modular and everything. And I kind of was trying to be as good as him at it for a while. And I wasn't going to get as good as him with all that. So I, you know, more, again, coming from the piano when I was young, a little more of a piano guy, I guess, and using sequencers, step sequencers, a little more for modulation these days. I find they're really handy for that because that's something that's a real pain to sort of draw in with automation and stuff. So, like, for instance, I've got a pingable envelope generator, which I generally patch into my Schwamann S1, and I think that's just awesome sauce recipe. I love doing that. It's sort of like hardware, you know, serum or something. It's just the way you can get the modulation to work. Stanton Smooker asks, what's your technique for layering percussion? For me, the trick is kind of not to overlayer it because then things just kind of get cloudy and murky. I feel like I layer too much if the sounds aren't right, right? Like, so it's like, oh, this could use a bit of that. Maybe if put this underneath, maybe I'll do an effect. I'll tuck that underneath. And then it's just like a big mess rather than like just the one perfect kick drum on its own. You know, there's a lot of tunes that just have a kick and they're fantastic. And it gives it a lot of room to breathe. You know, it's the old saying of it's about the space between the notes and all that. So if there is layering going on, just being aware of what's stepping on another layer frequency-wise and just kind of trying to keep that managed. I think that's the special recipe for keeping that all coherent and powerful. Adnan asks, how complex are the harmonies in your tracks? Is your harmonic structure based on one chord, or do you use complex progressions, or just monolines, counterpoint? It depends on what I'm working on. I don't know if I myself would ever call my harmonies complex, because I'm not a, you know, total trained professional pianist or anything. So I do what I can, but I feel like I have kind of a sense for melody and harmony, and kind of, piecing stuff together. So, yeah, I don't know if I'd call the progressions complex, but I try to throw some surprises in there sometimes. Not my friend who produces his goss, Natan H, always has this joke with me of not coming in on the root or coming in on a different beat. And as long as he keeps making that joke, I feel like I'm doing a good job basically not being obvious. So I guess that's the thing. Like, I keep it in my mind fairly simple, but I don't want to be obvious about it. So I think for me, that's the goal. And obviously, I'm trying to learn more. So to get a little more, to challenge myself, but also not to reinvent the wheel, right? As I was just talking about earlier, just to kind of embrace where I'm at, but to take it to the next level. I've got a question from Hugh Roberts. After so many years making music, what keeps things fresh and exciting for you? Do you ever feel like selling all your gear and taking up gardening instead? Yeah, fresh and exciting, it's just those moments of something new, something that I didn't know about, something that makes me want to try something, something that, like, I can't believe I didn't know about that. I'd never heard of that. There's always things to discover. So those are really inspiring, obviously new music as well. And hanging out with my awesome creative friends, you know. I've never had that moment, luckily, where I felt like I'm packing it in, get rid of everything. I mean, you know, a fresh start sometimes seems appealing, but that's sort of a different kind of perspective on it. So I've been lucky. I always enjoy working in music tech in some way, whether it's, yeah, one of many things. So I just consider myself lucky. I have got a question from Kieran Crone. If you could collaborate with any artist, who would be? Collaboration, first of all, like, it generally happens in person. That's part of the fun. A lot of my friends, like Arian Laviste, we've been working together for 30 years. And that's like how we hang out. Like, we might grab a meal or a drink or do something else, but most times we end up in here or some studio and we flip on machines, we start working, and we have like a little conversation. We know each other so well, we don't even have to talk about it with who's going to do what. Same with working with Reggie, who's a newer collaborator. It's just this fun hang. It's almost like releasing the music is like the last thing I think of. In fact, a lot of times it doesn't even cross my mind that I should put it out. So yeah, I feel like I'm already working with these people. And I mean, I am open to making awesome new friends and working with them. But yeah, just that thought of, I mean, I know it's a dream scenario, but I feel like the biggest fun part of it is hanging with your friends. So I guess it could be which producer would be a friend to make. I don't know. So unfortunately, I don't have a great answer apart from all the obvious, from all the, you know, big names that inspire. But I think I would almost just like to be a fly on the wall, just to see stuff that nobody else sees, you know, that maybe that producer doesn't share with the rest of us. Let's see. So I've got a question from Mogul Productions. How much electronic music do you listen to in your free time? What about other genres? You know, sometimes it's not that much, but at the moment it's a lot, but it's all different genres. I don't think it's not a ton of club music. I don't know. Sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't, but I really kind of enjoy a lot of avant-garde and experimental, a lot of 90s drum and bass. Yeah, I find it's all connecting, it's all inspiring. I mean, generally, I'll find a lot of inspiration from other styles. Like drum and bass as a reference again, like what I really always appreciate about it and some of the newer sort of bass stuff at different BPMs is it's just sort of so thematic. And someone else asked about an intro, right? I like that that music has an intro and then it sort of starts and it's very thematic. So that's really inspiring to get me to not just sort of, you know, start a track without the bass line and then like have it come in or whatever. So that's something cool that I want to get into. I've got a question from Zevius, possible name. They ask, what did you learn the last 20 years about monitors and why did you end up with these? I think by these, you might be referring to the picture that we had in the Ask Us Some Questions, which the monitors were at the shop and I had some very cool speakers my friend built. But at the moment, I've ended up with ATC SMC25s. I just think they're absolutely lovely and they sound great in this room, and I just love them, and I just love listening to music on them, which I haven't had a pair of speakers that just make me want to, you know, anytime I'm bored, I just want to run in here and put a record on and just sit there and let it hug me. So, I mean, that's what it's all about, right? So, speaking about inspiration, nice monitoring can definitely inspire you to want to just hear sound and to be in it and to make it. I don't even know. It's K question mark RM question mark Z question mark HAP. What do I do to keep my ears healthy? K Can I give some advice to prevent ear damage from noise and long hours at high decibel levels? Around about 20 or so years ago, I just sort of knew it was important to get fitted earplugs, or I think a friend had those, and I was just really curious, you know, and that had a big impact because when they're fitted and you can choose your own filters, it really just sounds like someone turned the music down. It doesn't sound like foam plugs that are very, you know, change the frequency drastically and sound bad. So very quickly, it got to the point where, like, I can't even enter a loud space concert or even performing without them in. It sort of, like, just sort of calms me down. It lowers the volume a little bit, which can be odd because the physicality of the space can still, you know, it's something to get used to. But yeah, I wear those religiously. When I'm home monitoring, I've just kind of gotten used to, even if I'm using headphones, just keeping it low. And then you kind of start to appreciate working low because you don't have that low end kind of mismatching your levels. You get a bit of a truer sound, and then obviously you do need to hear it hitting a little harder sometimes, and you can just turn it up for that. But I think I generally have better results with lower monitoring anyway. So all that has definitely helped. I'm very lucky to not have ringing in my ears when I'm sitting around. So I'm very, very thankful for that. So I'm going to try to keep it that way. I've got a question from 53NZR. How important is an agent in development of a renowned artist? That's a good question. Different examples. So I've never had an agent. I've had booking agents, but never had an agent. I've enjoyed the process of getting to know the business for better or worse and kind of trying to figure that out. I do have some quite successful friends that don't want anything to do with that and just want to focus on the creative side. And I think that's great as well. Sometimes I wonder, like, what would that be like? but I sort of like to be behind the scenes and think about my options and my plans. And sometimes it's just hard to talk directly to people about business. You know, it's just easier to have that buffered middleman. So it just depends what works for you and your personality. I don't think there is a right or wrong way to do it. If you want to be your own boss and take care of the business side and that feels natural to you, I'd say go for it. And if it's something you just don't want to deal with at all, I think that's totally fine too. But in that case, you'd have to find the right person that isn't going to get you work that you don't want to do. So I've got a question from, how do you say this name? Max. Thank you for the best name out of the whole episode. I know I got that one right. What's my opinion on VR modular sound environments like Patch XR? I think it's super interesting tech. I want to get into stuff like Touch Designer. I am not very proficient with that. With Wahada, we had a VR experience video with a producer named Seacliff. I'd done an immersive VR thing with a tool called Volta for the Atlanta Museum of Design. It's all very interesting. I generally like to collaborate with visual artists because I feel like I think visually a bit, but I don't feel super creative in that way. Like, I feel creative on the audio side. And it's really fun to collaborate with somebody that is as passionate about the visual side as I am about the audio side. And we sort of, like, get each other. We don't exactly know how the other side works, but we feel locked in. So while I'm interested in the tech, I've still got a really long way. But it's all super interesting. El Carzo asks, what hardware software would you recommend to somebody who wishes to make their first track? I mean, these days, there's so much stuff, right? There's very affordable, awesome hardware if you want to go that route. Stuff that runs on batteries. Stuff like an MPC Live with a built-in speaker. I mean, you can do everything with that. Or something a little more limited. Obviously, many, many producers using Ableton. I would say figure out if working on a laptop resonates with you or if you don't want to do that, you don't want to look at the screen, you want to work with hardware, essentially it's all doing the same stuff, right? I know this is like a huge debate sometimes, but you're dealing with sampling, synthesis, rhythm, melody, you know, even just some basic effects. So there's many, many ways to accomplish that, whether it's hardware or software. You just got to essentially find your instrument and see what's going to work for you. And I don't think you'll be making a wrong decision then, even if it's a choice that isn't what everyone else is doing. It's important that it fits you and your approach. Well, that wraps it up. Thanks so much, everyone, for all your questions. Thank you, Electronic Beats, for having me on for your Ask the Producer segment. It was a lot of fun, and I hope to see you all soon. Thanks. Bye.